Hello and welcome to C++ Weekly. I'm your host Jason Turner, available for code reviews and on-site training. In this episode, I'm going to cover an implementation of Quicksort from a long-time friend and supporter of the channel, Kobe. Now, Kobe sent me this example and was comparing it to a different Quicksort implementation and was wondering how to make his Quicksort implementation faster so that it performed similarly to the other implementation. And there was a couple of things that I spotted in here that I just thought would make some great C++ weekly episodes. Now my plan is to show you two changes that are almost imperceptible, to the point that you would not expect that there's any way at all that they could make as much of an impact as they do. So hopefully I will in fact blow your minds and we will dig in to what the changes are. So my plan right now is that this will be two episodes. And in the first one here, we're just gonna start at the top and we'll see what we find. Now, the first thing that I want to call your attention to is this line 8 right here, int lowest equals 0. Now, lowest is keeping track of the position that has the lowest value here, and things are being incremented until they're found, whatever. I don't fully understand this implementation, but it is supposedly a correct implementation. But this lowest index is an int. And now what we're starting with is we are 1.3 times slower than the other implementation. So we're looking at sort. Sort Geeks is the faster one. We're looking at sort. We are 1.3 times slower. So if I do this and make this a size t, what's going to happen? Now, if you've seen this talk from CppCon 2016 with Chandler Carruth, you might be expecting that the signed integer is actually going to end up being faster than the unsigned integer. And I have, in fact, had several people come up to me and tell me that they only used signed integer math because of this talk, without considering the other implications in the code. So let's go back to this now. We've got the 1.3 times slower version, and I have changed this from an int to a std size t, which is an unsigned 64-bit integer. And I'm going to rerun the benchmark. Now, with that one simple change, I have gone from 1.3 times slower to 1.2 times slower. That's a nearly 10% performance improvement. So let's pull this up in Compiler Explorer and see what we can learn. Okay, so we have the size t version up here now, and I'm going to go ahead and create a second version with the integer version, and we're going to use Compiler Explorer's ability to diff. I am in GCC trunk at the moment with -03 enabled. All right, so I have what should be identical views here. I've got our versions both with size t with GCC trunk of 03, and I've got the diff view here. Now I'm gonna go ahead and change the right-hand side. So the right-hand side should be our editor 2. It is. I'm gonna change our editor 2. No, let's change editor 1, sorry, to be the int, so that this is the original version. And we're gonna see what compiled code looks like here, what the difference is. Okay, so the code on the left panel is the code that was generated with int, and the code on the right is the code that was generated with size t. So let's just immediately note that we've got 7 extra instructions generated with the integer version. Let's see if we can make this all just a little bit bigger and more readable and try to dig into some of the diffs. All right, move R8D into RCX. So this starts with R8, multiply by 4. This is a load effective address. So on the size T version, it's able to do this 64-bit operation. Let's see, RDI plus R8 times 4, RDI plus RCX times 4. This just looks like it used an extra register. Not 100% sure why it would do that, although I'm guessing it's because it actually has to do a sign extension operation for any of these accesses. Because if this is an integer and I'm passing this into right here, what is a index operation into the span, which is expecting an unsigned 64-bit T, it's going to have to do a sign extension on this integer value and then promote that from 32-bit to 64-bit. And then it's going to have to do the same thing here. And then when it gets returned on the stack, it's returning an int, and then that is going to become down here, this value P. It's going to have to do that extension again here somehow, and again here with this 64-bit expression on line 23. So it does kind of seem to be the same pattern each time, that it's copying this R8D into another register, doing an addition, and then doing some other operation on it. And it's able to skip that each time in the 64-bit version. Some of these things just look reordered, but largely the same, using slightly different registers each time. This move SX, let's look at that, mouse over that, copies the contents of a source operand and sign extends the value to 16 or 32 bits in the Intel 64-bit architecture, blah, blah, blah. So it is having to explicitly do a move with sign extension here, and another move with sign extension down here. And that seems to be the bulk of it. It seems to mostly come down to doing the sign extension operations that it has to do each time it goes from a signed 32-bit integer to an unsigned 64-bit integer. So the real takeaway here is that you should just use the correct type. Now, unfortunately, it's just unbelievably difficult to convince people to use the correct type when they're doing this kind of operation, but we've clearly seen here that it can have a real-world considerable impact. So let's just go ahead and pull up our compiler warnings. And this is from compiler number one, and I don't have any warnings at all that it's having to do the sign extension each time, and I actually need to turn on dash W conversion, and I should, still not seeing the warnings. Why am I not seeing W conversion warnings, GCC? Oh, I see compiler one and compiler two got swapped in my view here. Yeah, no, I'm just not getting conversion warnings from GCC. That is very unfortunate. So let's just go ahead and change both of these to clang and see what we get. Okay, so changing it to clang and having W conversion enabled, I finally actually get these warnings, this implicit conversion changes signedness. I don't know why I was not seeing this on GCC with W conversion enabled. I find that quite distressing considering the amount of impact that we just saw that it could have on our runtime performance. And lest you think that this is a problem that is specific to GCC, we can actually see more of these move with sign extension instructions and a similar kind of fallout from Clang's compilation of this code. So yeah, be aware of that. Use the correct types and avoid signed, unsigned integer conversions. They can have a real impact in your code. And enable your warnings, right? We already have the best practice that if we had our warnings all enabled on here and were compiling with multiple compilers, we would have seen this seemingly incredibly simple, innocent problem very quickly.